This episode of the Boat Geeks is sponsored by The Boater's Guide, a free app for Pacific Northwest boaters. The Boater's Guide is adventure and information right at your fingertips, right when you need it. Find your happy place with The Boater's Guide, a free download on your phone or tablet in the App Store and Google Play.
Hey, Darren.
Darren.
Well, we did it. We recorded our first Boat Geeks podcast.
That was fun.
It was absolutely fun. We did, our first guest for our first podcast was Jennifer Silva Redmond, author of Honeymoon at Sea, How I Found Myself Living on a Small Boat. And that was a fun podcast.
That was a fun book to read. Yes. Also. In fact, when I finally finished it, I looked at Lisa and said, let's go to Mexico.
It is. Yeah. I mean, absolutely. Right. I find a good book like that, nonfiction oftentimes motivates you to want to get out there and adventure, you know,
inspiring.
Very inspiring. And as she was a lot of fun to talk to. Of course, again, the title of the book is Honeymoon at Sea, How I Found Myself Living on a Small Boat. It was funny, after I did the intro for the podcast, I thought about it and I realized that subtitle, How I Found Myself Living on a Small Boat, had kind of a double meaning, because in my head, the way I felt like I stated the title during the podcast is like, all of a sudden she discovered, hey, I'm living on a small boat, as if she didn't know that was going to, become her life. But also it could imply that how I found myself,
absolutely,
an aspect of her personality or her interests that she didn't know existed, previous to, diving in the deep end, so to speak, and boating. And so, a very good, title of a book, of course, and a very great guest to have on the podcast.
Absolutely.
A lot of fun. All right. So here it is. Here's our first Boat Geeks podcast with Jennifer Silva Redmond. Welcome to the premiere episode of the Boat Geeks podcast. Today, our special guest, our first guest ever on the podcast, is Jennifer Silva Redmond, both an editor full-time as her job and a first-time author. Her book is Honeymoon at Sea, How I Found Myself Living on a Small Boat. And although I just purchased this on Amazon, I have not read it yet. I'm very much looking forward to reading it. And my co-host, Darren, I know you've already dug a little bit into the book, right?
According to Kindle, I have about 32% left.
Ooh.
That's so very good.
I tried to finish
it. Nice, nice job. So you'll be able to answer or ask some questions directly from what you've read. We have so many questions for you, Jennifer, but real quick, I just want to let everybody know they can get Honeymoon at Sea on Amazon like I did. However, it would be more beneficial to Jennifer if you would go to your local bookstore and order it, because that brings it to their attention. They see that there's demand for the book. Maybe they order three, maybe they order four, and put it on the shelf and more people can pick it up. But once you do order it and purchase it at your local bookstore, please go on to Amazon and drop a review, a positive review for this book, and help her sell more, because we need more true sailors out there and that are documenting their experience and
that are good.
That are good at writing. Yes, she's an editor.
Oh my gosh, yes.
We'll get more into that.
Breath of fresh air, definitely.
But is that correct, Jennifer? That's what we want them to do. We want them to purchase it and go review it, right?
Absolutely. I will look forward to hearing every review, and I love getting the feedback from people, which has been wonderful so far. I really appreciate that. And yes, it's wonderful to have individual indie bookstores be aware of it. I'm really excited to hear more from booksellers and readers.
Wonderful. Well, we're so happy to have you here today and to talk about your book and your life. This is a book a long time in the making, right? Like how many years did it take you to write this book?
Well, I guess you could say it took me 34 years in a sense, because in 1989, Russell and I were married in May of 1989, and we took off November 11th. It's coming up now on 34 years. So that first trip that I started documenting in my little, you know, spiral-bound notebook, my ship's log each night, you know, we went here, we went there, and, you know, how I felt about it, what I was experiencing. I actually started it in September of that year when we moved onto the boat, and I have pages where I'm talking about provisioning, like, how this box of pancake batter looks like it's like the size of Chicago, you know, where do I put this, or, you know, how do I, you know, stock this? And this is a very small boat. I mean, it's 26-foot boat. So
a Columbia 26. For those out there that are aware.
Exactly. Yeah. So sailors will know there's not a lot of storage space. And we had two folding bikes. We had, we did not have an inboard engine. We had an outboard engine on that boat. So so there was a little more space below, and we had lazarettes out back. But it's, you know, so the main salon had, you know, the hammock, you know, the ubiquitous cruiser hammock full of
fruit
and veggies.
Well, I have one quick question.
Yeah.
In terms of storage.
Sure.
Not only is it a small boat and you had two folding bikes, Russell had how many head sails aboard? Six?
We had six or seven. I think there might have been seven.
The sail bags would take up a ton of room on a Columbia 26. Yeah. That's incredible.
Yeah, we had a 180, a 150, a 110, a storm jib, and the Reacher Drifter. There's another one because I know there were six. But yeah, and we would sometimes see them all in a day.
Oh my gosh.
I think our record was like 9 sail changes in a day, you know. Wow. But Russ would say it's all part of my active lifestyle.
Eking out every quarter of a knot.
No kidding.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I have so many questions about a 26-foot, the choice to live aboard a 26-foot sailboat. But first, I'd really like to...
Who made that choice?
Yes, indeed. But obviously you survived. But I'd like to go back even further. Like,
sure.
What is your experience growing up with boats? Did you have any experience, your family or something like that? What got you interested in boats? What led to this decision?
It's a very simple answer. Absolutely none. I had no experience sailing. But I was in theater as a teenager, and I met Russell doing a play, Our Town by Thornton Wilder, at the Old Globe Theater in San Diego. And I fell for him pretty much, you know, right then. And but I was 14, so, you know, common decency and the state law, as he put it. So he, you know, it fended me off very gently, and I just kept showing up in his life. And I knew he was interested. He lived on the beach even then, and I knew he was interested in boating. And so we saw each other on and off over the years. And at one point, we dated for quite a while. And then he broke my heart. He hates when I tell this part, but he did. And so I went as far as I could, which was New York City, to get away from him, you know, so I didn't make a fool of myself. And when I came back to visit family, we got together, had lunch, and he proposed, like you do. And he took me out sailing with my brother and his wife at the time. I mean, they're still together. I mean, me and his wife at the time. We went sailing together, and that night he proposed. And I said, you know, fine, you live here in San Diego. I'm not going to drop all this that I've been working for 5 years in New York. And he said, no, I'll move to New York. And I went, what? So that's when I knew he was serious. And then fast forward to New York City, not long after that, we were sitting on the Upper West Side in my apartment, and it's snowing outside. And I said, like you do when you're in love, what would you do, honey, if you could do anything in the world? And he said, you and I would get on that boat and we'd sail down to Mexico.
Wow.
And I went, I looked outside, I looked at him,
I went,
okay, tell me more. And so we got out the Atlas, and I was doing that thing with your hands where you're like, 100 miles a day, I can do that. You know, we would make it to the Panama Canal in like 4 months. And he's like, uh-huh. And of course, you know, he wasn't going to dissuade me from this madness. So he said, sure, yeah, we can do that.
Now, you said that boat.
Yeah.
Was it a specific boat? Did he have?
He already had the boat. He'd gotten the boat in 1982, and this we got married in 89. So he'd been working on it. So I have spent much time in boatyards since then, but I did not have to do one bit of work on the boat in terms of that kind of you know, the real boatyard kind of work. I did the netting because he had a friend who had been a tuna fisherman, so he showed me how to do the actual tuna twine netting, which was really cool, and I wish I could remember how to do. Now I buy it at West Marine like everybody else. But yeah, I mean, I did things like that, did some decorative boat knotting, you know, line knotting, stuff like that. And yeah, so we took off in, you know, 6 months after getting married, and I knew nothing. I mean, I'd been to Mission Bay, which people from San Diego know that's like 8 miles. Yep. Been overnight on the boat once. So I definitely was taking a big leap. And a lot of people thought that was pretty crazy. Russel said, yeah, this is a recipe for divorce. But he also said, she's been an actor in New York City. How much tougher can life be than that? So she can handle this.
So what was, if you didn't grow up with boats, I'm assuming Russel did to some extent. What was Russell's experience with the boat? And did he purchase this boat when you were together? Do you remember the purchase of it or anything like that?
No, he bought the boat when we were, dating, but it wasn't a mutual, right. I mean, he was buying the boat and I knew about the boat, but I didn't spend any time. I was doing other things. I was, you know, pursuing my career. And he actually is from Iowa. So he moved to Oceanside as a little kid with his family. And so he grew up at the ocean as I did. And both of us were, you know about body surfing and waves and that sort of thing, but not boating per se. But he lived on a boat briefly as a college student and always wanted to have a boat. And his brother was into boating and the whole family. So he got this boat in 82. And as I say, he spent a lot of time fixing it up and painting. It was gorgeous. It had that that really nice navy blue hull with a kind of a tan deck, and it was gorgeous. I mean, people would really point and stare at it. I mean, I couldn't take any credit, but I was very proud of it in spite of that. So, but yeah, and he taught me how to sail. I mean, we basically just went out and went in circles in San Diego Bay like everybody else does. And he, you know, saw me white knuckling. And it's like, this is not an F-18. You're not, nothing's going to go wrong that fast. Just relax, enjoy. And there was no yelling and screaming. He just said, you know, don't worry, I'm right here. And I think he was just so calm about it, you know, that I enjoyed it from the very beginning, you know.
I think it's really interesting, having read most of the first half, which centers on that first trip down to Mexico. I'm at the point where you're heading towards mainland. And so in this part of the book, she's writing about learning, not how to sail, but how to live aboard and provision and the social interactions with other cruisers and so forth. And that was 34 years ago. This woman has more sailing experience
in her pinky than
most people that have boats in this marina.
Sure.
So I have to remind myself reading this and then talking to you now, those are two different people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was sailing. I know what you're saying. I mean, I was 28 and I had literally I'd been on, you know, ferries and that sort of thing, you know, or maybe on a cruise ship like for a day. I didn't know anything. But I think once again, you know, I have to give Russel a lot of credit. One of the things he did was when we left San Diego, we went to the Los Coronados. Then we went to Todos Santos Island. Then we went to, you know, Punta Baja. And then we went to, you know, San Quintin. And every night we would anchor, because no matter how, you know, unsure, anxious, you know, scared, tired, exhausted, you know, nauseous, whatever you might be during the day, once you anchor, it's like your little home and it feels secure. And as soon as you eat, if you can, you know, have the time to eat before you pass out, you know, from exhaustion, and every day was a fresh day. You know, and then as Darren has read, as Darren O'Brien has read, I had to do my first night watch, and that was really a major come to Jesus moment, you know. It was really a big life change. It was a big, now, you know.
Was that first night watch, and one of my, I love the quote from Desiderata.
Mm-hmm.
About
that was it.
That night sailing, yep, under the constellations. And, oh, I get goosebumps just thinking about that moment. Because I've sailed under a moonless night just the Milky Way. And it's transcendent. It is absolutely.
And you feel, at first, I felt almost, and it sounds crazy, claustrophobic. It was like there was so much space that there was nothingness.
I get that, yeah.
That I almost was like, a proto panic attack. You know, I was just like, can I do this? I mean, I'm like out here, there's nothing to guide me but this little red dot on this compass. I mean, will the boat crash? Will I, you know, and I was not going to go below and say, come up and hold my hand, you know? I mean, you just can't do that, you know? So I'm stubborn. And I was like, okay, I'm going to do this. And I just, you know, deep breaths and all that. And then little by little, as you say, I started thinking, you know, people have been doing this for thousands of years with less I have here. You know, though we didn't have a GPS at the time, you know, we did know where we were and, you know, following our line of position and all this navigation stuff that I had been learning to do was like, oh, it's happening. And to find that next day that we were heading right towards those islands, the little smudge appears on the horizon. We were jumping up and down. And then you forget how long it's going to take for that little smudge on the horizon tip. I mean, forever.
Yeah.
It takes forever. It's like the entire day was waiting to actually pull into that anchorage.
Well, and under sail in those conditions, I mean, the average conditions that you encountered, you were doing, what,
four knots on a good day.
Yeah, so, yeah, it takes a while for that island on the horizon to rush up on you.
Long time.
But it's not about the destination. It's the journey. So.
Absolutely.
Which you would have realized if at the time you had the resources that a person has today. For example, all the GPS, instrumentation that is available now. Or you could, for any single thing that you want to know about boating, there's YouTube videos
you
can go learn. You can see other people experiencing it live.
Yep.
Back then, you had none of that. And while people have been sailing by the stars and instruments for thousands of years, it still had to be, you know, stepping off a cliff. You have no idea what's going to happen. And that sense of adventure, in some ways, I'm jealous because you can't really get that the same way these days, you know, which in a lot of ways is great because the safety equipment and instrumentation, you can know where anybody is at any time. It's great stuff to have. Mm-hmm. If you have loved ones out at the ocean, you want them, you know, at the sea, you want them to have all that available to them. But what an adventure, you know?
It really is true that it is, the book is a time capsule. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not only a time capsule of what sailing was like. I mean, I'd read Lynn and Larry's book. I'd read a handful of other, you know, Sterling Hayden, all that, you know, Russell gave me, like, you must read these. And actually, the name Watchfire comes from an epigram that was in a Sterling Hayden book. And so I knew it conceptually, you know, and but to be out there is completely different, and especially as we were saying in the night with just the stars, but there's also as you say is that this completely new life that you weren't getting all the tutorials for. You don't have that, you know, wait, back it up, what did he say I'd do next that we all do at YouTube University now.
Yeah.
It's totally different.
You had to invent it.
We were writing it as we went along, and we had come across some things. I think I mentioned about the blue and pink jobs, you know, girls have pink jobs and boys have blue jobs, and we were like, not so much. Because there were just things that I was better suited for and that he was better suited for. And we've always been a little purple, you know, we're not tied into those things. But I found that there were things that, like, I loved, speaking of the navigation, I loved getting out the, you know, the big text that has, you know, all the gosh, I'm HO249.
Boat ditch.
Yeah, exactly. And looking up, you know, what the declination and the day and the difference between to right now and Greenwich Mean, and figuring it out and going, here's where we should be. And oh my God, there's our line of position. And we're pretty darn close. And that's pretty, it was exciting. It was really exciting.
How has that changed over 30 plus years? Like, do you,
we turn on our Garmin and, you know, we just everything goes through the, you know, we've got a big Garmin chart plotter, and we've got AIS, and we've got radar, and I'm glad to have it, as you say. I mean, there's absolutely no way that I would do, especially Puget Sound, because not only the weather, but the currents. Y'all have some currents up here. They're like serious, and being able to plot when you're going to get to a place, you know, and then, of course, you got your phone with all your apps, Deep Zoom and Active Captain, and, you know, all these things. And it is nice to know those things. It is, and you know, Russel says, I used to go looking for trouble till I found out how much trouble there was. And, you know, and the other saying we say to ourselves all the time is, when you've got all your eggs in one basket, watch that basket. I mean, our boat has our life in it now. We don't have a house anymore. We don't have, you know, we got the boat, you know, so we're a lot more cautious than people who are out, you know, for the weekend on their playboat.
Oh, yeah. And
Not dissing them at all for how they look at it.
It's completely different.
It's just like a sports car versus your work truck.
Yeah.
You know,
absolutely.
I think that was interesting how you referred to cruising in Puget Sound versus elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And I really want to get into your impressions of the Salish Sea.
Mm-hmm.
But you guys went through the Panama Canal, and talk a little bit about the mainland of Mexico and going through the canal and up to New York and so forth.
Well, just to catch people up, I mean, we went down to the Sea of Cortez for 3 months, and we ended up spending a year. And we just loved it so much. And so, you know, the book covers that time that we spent down there, but it ends with the Panama Canal, because really that was the year and the honeymoon.
Mm-hmm.
And we loved going down the mainland. We crossed over near Puerto Vallarta, and we sailed down the coast and stayed in Acapulco and Huatulco and just beautiful places. And I think we put up our Reacher Drifter the day we got there and never took it down. I mean, just like an incredibly wonderful, just a steady offshore breeze that was just like heavenly. And we
What did you call that sail? What was the name? Some of the sails had nicknames, and that was a good one. I can't remember.
He wanted to call it the Hulking Bastard. I think the other one was called the Hulking Bastard.
But we'll having that Reacher up was
just like a light little like a lazy man's spinnaker, and it would just cut just perfectly. So it would just fly along, and we just sailed down the coast like that. It was gorgeous, and we went through the Tuanapec that everybody warns you about, and that was, you know, no problem.
You didn't encounter a Tuanapecker?
We did not. Oh, we had a great trip, and everything was great. We got down to Nicaragua. And we actually were off of, now I know that we were off of the massive Lake Nicaragua, which is you know, on the inside of the state or the country.
Yeah.
But the wind comes across from the Atlantic over that very low, just like the Tuanapec. And it's got a name that I can't think of right now. Papagayo wind, I think. And we were way offshore, and we were sailing south, and it was getting pretty spicy. And Russel said, that's going too fast. You know, I mean, the wind increase happened too quickly. We're going to go into shore. And I was kind of thinking, you know, by then I thought I knew kind of a lot about sailing, and I was pretty, you know, like, let's not be so cautious. We can make some time. Let's get down there. And we went in and anchored just outside of the break. I mean, just outside of the waves. And we were there for 5 days, and it blew 60 plus knots.
Wow.
And it was exactly the right thing to do. I mean, it would have been in a boat we'd been buddy boating with was lost in that storm.
Oh, no.
Though the people were rescued.
Oh, good.
Their boat was lost.
That's kind of unusual in terms of rescues at sea, because the boats often pop up.
Yeah, elsewhere. It was a ham radio link to a VHF link to a ham radio link in Alaska that called somebody somewhere else. And some Colombian tanker picked them, and they stepped up off their boat onto that tanker and were rescued. But the boat went down, and it was a big, I want to say a 45-foot schooner. I mean, it was a good sized boat. Mm. But
so was that your first scary experience, or was it even scary? Were you in a safe anchorage and it was fine? Was that your first kind of eye-opening experience of what the ocean could be like or living out there?
Well, sailing, many people who've been around the world will agree with me that the Sea of Cortez has some of the most uncomfortable seas, and they call them square seas because the seas are coming from four different directions. So the trip from Cabo to La Paz, which we've done now twice, is never fun. They call it bashing for a reason. So it's uncomfortable, but obviously the shore's right there. I mean, you don't think you're going to die. I mean, you might think you're going to swim to shore, but you're not going to die. Crossing the Sea of Cortez up higher up, like when we were crossing to San Carlos in the late 90s, that was, you know, that's no fun. But once again, you know, it's a small passage. But when you're out at sea, you know, an offshore like that, and your next step is, you know, if you keep getting blown that way, next step Tahiti, you know, next step Hawaii, whatever. It is really a lot more exciting. But because we were always, and because Russel has good instincts, clearly, and I would have been like, no, let's go faster. when we left that anchorage, actually, it ended up just being tedious, really, to be at that anchorage. Because after a while of it blowing 60 knots, you're like, that's blowing 60 knots, whatever. Again. You know, and we have nothing left to eat. You know, I think we're eating the, you know, those decorative beans that you have beans and rice in like a canister. We literally were boiling those beans, you know, but we also use them for poker chips. And I finally had the time to teach him to play poker because he really hates card games and board games of every kind. And then I dealt him a real straight flush, which I've never lived that one down.
And then you ate your winnings.
And then we ate our winnings. Exactly. Rice and beans. You will never run out of rice and beans.
So I keep going back in my head to it being a 26-foot boat, because before I purchased my first boat, Iron Feather, which is a few slips over now, the first boat I was actually looking at was a 26-foot sailboat that was docked right across the bay here. And that was for a weekender. I can't imagine living on a 26-foot boat, maybe by myself. But what was that experience like, being on a 26-foot boat? How many years were you on that boat? And what did it feel like when you moved into your current and bigger boat?
Well, the wonderful thing about me living on a 26-foot boat is that I didn't know there was anything else. It's like, you know, talk to somebody that grew up in a backcountry cabin with an outhouse. What was it like growing up? It was like growing up, you know, Angela's ashes, right? You know, I mean, ask the guy, right? It was just the way you grow up. So for me, there was nothing sad about it. It was, I'm on a boat. I'm living on a boat with the person I'm madly in love with. So I've got no problem. It was, the first few months were colder than I expected them to be because Baja's not really warm in November and December or January. But once it started warming up, the great thing about a boat is you're really living outside, you know, and as I said to somebody recently, it's like when you go camping, you don't say this tent is awfully small. Right. You think these Sierras are really big, right, or this Olympic Peninsula is so stunning.
Very
you don't
point.
Sit there and obsess about the size of your, you know, you get in your little pup tent or in your little mummy sleeping bag and you sleep really cozy. Yeah. And the fact that it's so small is really great because you stay warm and dry. So boats are meant to keep the water out and the dark out and the scary out. And so when you're in a boat, you know, it's you know, you have that feeling of coziness. But during the day, we were diving and snorkeling and swimming and sailing and gliding along under the beautiful skies. And sometimes it was too hot or too cold or too this or too that. But that would have been the same thing. Sure. Sitting in my backyard in San Diego.
Absolutely. So the world was your backyard.
The world is my backyard, and it still is.
Yeah.
I mean, and the cool thing is, of course, now for a couple months of the year, it can also be my freezer. You know, I can put things outside and keep the ice cream from melting.
Leftovers stay fresh.
We still don't have a freezer, but we have one right outside. So what happened to the original Watchfire is that we lived on it from 1989 to 2003. And in 2003, we'd taken the boat back to Baja. We trucked it back from Arizona. We were going to fix the boat up to sell it to get a bigger boat. And everybody knows that spending time fixing up a 26-foot boat to sell it is pretty much just throwing money away because you're never going to make that money back. But sure. Russell was like, no, we have to make it at least enough. So we were living on the boat in the backcountry of San Diego on some friend's property, and a big fire came through, and the boat ended up a pile of ashes, along with the very cool custom trailer we'd had made. But that enabled us to get the new boat. So it was not, I mean, it was sad, but it wasn't sad. I mean, it was a Viking funeral, which that boat totally deserved. Though Richard Spindler of Latitude 38, when we got the new boat, we'd sailed about like 2 miles in Newport Harbor, and we ran into Richard Spindler at the fuel dock in Newport Beach. And he goes, hey, how you guys doing? And we said, yeah, this is the new boat. And he goes, it was named Toad Hall at the time. And he goes, oh, you're going to keep that name? And we go, no, we're naming it Watchfire. And he goes, what are you guys, crazy? And we said, no, we're just not superstitious, you know. So we named it Watchfire.
Which is unusual for sailors.
Maybe. I know. Yeah. And Russell's got every other superstition under the sun, but sure. Not that one. So when we went looking for the next boat, I had we both had a list of things we wanted. Russell wanted inboard engine, and he wanted a sloop, which we'd had, and various other things. And I wanted two cabins, because I had seen that, because we now were planning to be working from home, and traveling as much as we could. At the time, Russell was teaching class in person, and we would have summers off. So we were going to go up and down the coast of California from San Diego to San Francisco, which we did. And we knew that working from the boat was going to be interesting. So I figured, if we had two cabins, if somebody's working, you have a little bit of privacy or a little bit of different working spaces. And he was still doing his artwork. And so, long story short, when we walked onto it, we just said, yeah, this is the boat for us. And
I think obviously living on a boat, being on a boat, creates a checklist in your mind of the things that you want in your next boat. You went from a 26 to a 34?
35.
So you added quite 8-9 feet. What was that like?
It's a big 35 too. I mean, yeah. It's really one of those boats. It's not super deep, like one of the Columbia 36s, but it's big, and it's roomy for a sloop, for a sailboat. And so the aft cabin, it also has a pass through on both sides, which I like. So I can be, cooking or something in the galley, and he can go through the other way, and it just makes life a little bit simpler. We have a dog, and we've got a life with a whole bunch of moving parts. So it's nice to have that. But I think what's funny is that people will say to me, how do you live? I mean, because to a landlubber, they still come onto a boat and go, it's so small, you don't have room. And I'm like, what is it that I don't have room for? And whenever I tell people this, they have a kind of an aha moment. It's like when you come home from work, you might take a shower, you might make a snack or whatever, and then you go sit in your chair, right? I mean, am I wrong?
And what's your view?
Right. So you're going to sit in your spot.
Yes.
Just like Sheldon, right? This is my spot.
Doesn't matter how big the room
exactly.
is. It's a chair.
That's the chair that you're comfortable in, or it might be your chair on the patio, or it might be your chair in front of the fireplace, depending on. But you're not going to be like up jigging around, You're not going to be dancing too many times in your house. You're not going to be, some people have a workout room, but most people don't work out in their living room. So basically, I've got a really cool spot. I put my feet up on the compression post, I lean back, I can sit there and read or look at my laptop. And when I walk outside, I've got the entire world, right.
People pay millions for the
world's
views that you get.
World's greatest backyard. Absolutely. At all times.
I once heard that for sailboats, it doesn't apply to power boats, but for sailboats, every, we've all heard of 2-foot itis, but for every 2 feet in length overall that you get in a sailboat, you virtually double your interior volume.
Exactly.
I don't know if that's accurate or not, but it, going from 26 to 35 was, you more than doubled your
absolutely.
Your living space.
It feels like you could have put Little Watchy inside our boat. I mean, it is exactly. really that much more roomy. Though our V berth is not that much bigger, and we still sleep in the V berth because we like each other.
There you go.
Like but you know, the back has got, you know, it's got our, you know, flat screen TV. I mean, we're like everybody else. We like to Netflix and chill, you know, like everyone else. And you know, you just kick back there and watch movies and you know, binge on Ted Lasso. I mean, it's all, you know, the same kinds of things that everybody else does. But I get to also, you know, we rowed ashore in our Portland Pudgy and, nice. You know, and get out and walk on a beach or, you know, tie up in front of a state park or like now, just walk up the gangway and, you know, take a stroll in Port Townsend. So
lovely.
It's a pretty nice life.
It's a pretty different life in the Puget Sound in Port Townsend than cruising Mexico or the ICW. Or
have you noticed that?
Well,
yes,
I haven't cruised or lived aboard full time in those areas, but yeah, they're vastly different.
Totally different. And we're loving it. But it is definitely every month has been a learning curve. You know, the summers that we've spent up here, cruising, you know, the San Juan Islands, we haven't even, you know, we've been to like 4 of them. I mean, there's so much left to do, but we've really enjoyed cruising the South Puget Sound, which people doesn't get as much press, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so many cool little islands and the state parks. Of course, we got the state park pass. So we go to all these little places out of the way, you know, that people don't write about. And of course, lovely Port Ludlow, where we are now, and Paulsbow, we love, and we really enjoy, you know, Blakely. I mean, there's just been so many lovely places, and we like Seattle. We enjoyed being in Seattle. Hate those locks. Can't say enough about that.
You're not alone on that. I
understand that.
Have you guys crossed the border?
We have not.
You haven't gone into Canada.
We could have thrown a rock over the border when we were heading for Roche Harbor, but it was just, we had a time crunch, and this book thing, it turns out I had a lot of, you know, publicity stuff to do and getting calls and getting books and deadlines, and people don't like when there's something like, okay, I made that change and we want to go to the printer and we need you to sign off on it. They don't want to hear from you the next day when you get to, you know, where you can. And we use a hotspot, so it's basically a cell signal, which is okay because T-Mobile goes over the border, but we were just, you know, the time it would take us to check in and get legal and all that, you know, we would be cutting into the time we had. So we went to Roche Harbor and had a great time in Friday Harbor.
What are your plans for now that the book is out? It's published. It's getting rave reviews.
Yes.
People love it. We love it. What are your plans for next summer?
Next summer is Sunshine Coast.
Oh,
because it's
there
got the
go.
Two things I like most in its name.
So you're a sun lover for sure.
Oh, I'm totally a sun lover. Yeah. And though we did have a life-changing experience, I will say, that made cruising up here completely different than it would have been, which is when we were in Sausalito a couple of years ago, we said, oh, we're right here with one of the great canvas makers. We should have them extend this. We had just a little Dodger and we had the top part, you know, the bimini, I guess you'd call it, attached to it. And that had been done. And we said, we should really enclose this because there's going to be so many times, oh my goodness, if we hadn't done that, it would totally have been a game changer. I mean, this was like, it's like adding a room to your house.
A sunroom.
It's like adding a sunroom.
Or it almost gives you a pilot house.
It does.
Because you're a center cockpit.
It does. Exactly. So you can see, you can steer from in there, of course. We have the chart plotter kind of pulls out so you can see it, you know, down the companionway. And you can look around and see everything. And sometimes even when we're sailing, I lower the sides. It's like, I can see what's out there. And it's just wonderful. And one of the things that I never thought of is like a greenhouse, that it can be 50 degrees and the and a wind blowing, but it's sunny, and you walk outside, 75 degrees in my little greenhouse. So I'll sit out there and read a book and sun my legs and, you know, feel like I'm in Mexico for a few hours. But yeah, Sunshine Coast, we're very excited about that. In the Gulf Islands, we haven't even touched. So that's, I mean, next chapter.
Oh my
the
gosh.
Honeymoon
You have many summers.
The honeymoon continues.
Well, you say that the honeymoon continues. Do you have future? I mean, obviously you're still in the midst of promoting this book and you just finished, but in the back of your mind, is there another book in on the way?
I hope so.
No.
The short answer is no.
People have talked to me about it. I five spiral-bound notebooks.
Yeah.
Good-sized notebooks went into this. I have like two notebooks of from the Panama Canal back to San Diego. I loved the Intercoastal Waterway. We adored it, and we adored, we spent time in Florida back when Florida was cool. And we had a blast. We had a lot of fun. We loved it. I mean, the natural beauty of that part of the world is just stunning. Mm-hmm. We love New Orleans and the Redneck Riviera that they call it there. It was gorgeous. But there really isn't enough of an, you know, it could be a nice article, I think, a long article, maybe a series of articles, but I just don't feel like there's an arc to it. There isn't a story to it. I mean, we're kind of go from where we were to where we were again.
I think I heard, I've listened to a couple podcasts and Live Your Best. No, what's the, Your Best Life. Anyway, don't remember the name of the podcast, but, in that you talked about not wanting this book just to be another travelogue of here's all the places we went, because you don't flashback, but you give context to what you're doing, where you're, what you're thinking from your childhood, how you were brought up. And so you weave in all these elements of your life, which is really makes it a very meaty read, right?
Thank you.
But as opposed to, okay, let's just write where we went.
Yeah, it was Follow Your Bliss.
A lot of books are.
Follow Your Bliss.
Follow
podcast.
Your Bliss. Yes,
yeah, and I think that's very true. And that's why when you ask a long time ago how long it took the book to get written, I really started putting stories together pretty quickly, maybe like 5 years after the trip. I started putting things into articles, and I wrote about finding Charlie, and I wrote about, you know, sailing the boat and learning how to sail and the night passage. And we came back down the second time actually in June, which people don't do. And so I wrote an article about that for Latitude, I think. So I'd gotten some things out there and some essays, and I knew that I wanted to write a book, but I didn't really know what it was going to say. I mean, I didn't really know the shape of it. I didn't really know the point of it. And I had written a book about my first year in New York, and it was in a drawer, and it deserved to be there. And then I started pirating things from that and thinking, oh, I could write that, and I could write this thing I wrote about growing up in the Venice canals, and I could write about traveling in Europe with my mom, and I could write about, you know, living in a commune, you know, with my hippie parents and things like that, and also struggling as an actor in New York and LA and what that was like, you know, the trying to live up to some ideal that changes daily, you know, and things like that. And I think that does make it more interesting. And funny enough, Elsie Hulsizer, who's a wonderful woman, sailor, adventurer, and author, and she read my book and gave me a wonderful blurb.
Oh, she's great.
And when I talked to her, she said, I have to tell you, when I first started reading it, I said, like, what's all this stuff got to do with anything? You know, why are you writing about being a kid? And then she said, and by the end, I wouldn't have changed a word. I loved it. And she said, it made it so much more interesting than most sailing books. And I just went,
absolutely.
Wow,
that's
thank
true.
You. It made my...
And, you know, I think another thing that's interesting is anyone can read this book and get so much out of it. And in terms of being able to relate, I mean, we were all children. We were all raised by parents or
wolves,
what have you. And then we've met, we've fallen in love. We've tried to careers, all this. So all those elements. And then you weave in learning how to sail and cruise and live aboard, and even landlubbers are going to get a sense for what that's like. But I dare say us boaters get a little bit more out of your book because we really know what you're talking about in some of those passages.
But I would say that it's probably totally relevant to, as we were discussing before the podcast, today there's people that are living in vans. There's people that are living in tiny homes made out of containers. There's, you know, down in Portland, there's a woman that built a hobbit home in the side of a hill, you know. And small spaces, I think, applies to a lot more people today than it did potentially back then.
Yeah.
Now, you were a bit of a pioneer in a lot of ways. One, choosing to live on a boat and sailing the world, but also working from your home, essentially. Now that's a much more common practice, especially after COVID. There's even more people doing it. What was it like for you discovering, you said, How I Found Myself, that's the subtitle of the book. What did you find? What did you find of yourself in this process of living in a small space, living amongst the world is your backyard, and how did you find your career, which is you're an editor, and you know, I'm guessing you were very hard on yourself in terms of writing the book because you were an editor and you've read so many books, good and bad. Just tell me about that whole process of learning to work from your home, being an editor, what that's like, and how that applied to writing a book yourself.
Well, it was a 25-year process, basically. Mm-hmm. 35-year process, I guess. When we took off, I mean, I wanted to be an actor. It's all I'd ever kind of pursued as a kid. I'd written as a kid, little books I wrote at like five. And I wrote in high school and, you know, had things, you know, in the school paper or whatever. So I always loved writing. And when we took off, you know, once again, this was going to be a short time, and then we were going to go to New York, and then it was going to be a longer time, but we were still going to New York. And then we got to Florida and things were going on, and, you know, we needed to get back to San Diego. Family things were happening. And it just seemed like, well, I can still pursue this, you know, I mean, Los Angeles, right? So I kept just kind of pushing the decision down the road a little bit. But meanwhile, I had started writing. And what I discovered in writing was threefold. One, I felt more creative than I ever had as an actor, because I wasn't going into somebody else's world and trying to make myself fit their idea. Also that I had something to say and that I could say it. And actors kind of only get to say what the other person tells them to say. Though I'd done a little playwriting, and my best friend was a playwright, and so there had been a lot of discussions between us about what we had to say, and I'd done plays where I'd gotten to write a bit and that sort of thing. But all of a sudden, I could like create people up out of whole cloth. I could make them up, and I could have them say whatever I wanted them to say, and the room could look how I wanted it, and the day could be, you know, the temperature or whatever. And it was pretty heady stuff. I thought this was pretty cool. And I thought, but of course I can't make a living at it, because no one can make a living as a writer, right? You know? So such enthusiasm I had. I'm pretty much an optimist, but I'm also a realist, a realistic optimist. So I said, you know, well, you know, I'll pursue that, and then I'll do something else, you know, to make money. And I can always wait tables and bartend and things that I knew how to do. And then in 1997, we were on the boat in Baja, and we had a whole new group of friends, and some friends of ours came over one day and said, you should do a book a collection like The New Yorker, only for people in Baja. And we were like, right, we thought you were our friends. and we thought, you know, that would be kind of cool to think about. It seems like an awful lot of work, which it was. And so we did something called the Sea of Cortez Review, 3 years running, and we would publish stories about Baja. And people would say, I have a story, I think, can you fix it? And I would get in and tinker with it, and we would work together. People would always say, I'm not a writer, but I wrote a story. And I'm like, okay, there's something contradictory there. But a lot of people feel like, and I would say, if you have a good story, all you have to do is get out of the way of it. Mm-hmm. You don't have to be a good writer. Mm-hmm. But if you have I think I've heard this story before, that's when you have to be a really good writer, you know? So there's two different kinds of writing. So I found that I really loved that. I really loved helping people sculpt something, you know, or in the context of what we're doing today, you guys can relate is I feel like when somebody's talking on the page, I'm there to get the static out. I'm there to get the voice clear,
yeah.
You know, just to make those words come across as clearly as possible so they don't go, huh, what, didn't she just say something else that contradicted that? I have to go back a page, you know, that kind of thing that throws you out of the whole magic of a story. So as an editor, that's what I try to do. And Steve Cortez Review actually led us to Sunbelt Books. And Sunbelt is in San Diego, and they're a publisher and distributor. So I started working with them, doing marketing, and I worked my way up to editor-in-chief. And then I realized that I was spending a lot of time in meetings and doing budgets and grant proposals and a lot of stuff that, you know, as usual in the corporate world, you know, you don't get to do what you want to do. You get to get do what's good for the company, you know. But I still work with them, and they're a wonderful company for books about Baja in Mexico and the United States and California, Southern California. So that's very cool. I get to still find projects for them. I'm their editor at large. I'm at large. So that, you know, and we were just so lucky that we both were already working from the boat.
Yeah.
That when the pandemic came, I feel guilty even saying it, but it just hardly affected us at all. Yeah. We were just really lucky in that we were able to, you know, Russel had been working teaching online for like 4 years by then. So it was really an easy, and we just love working from the boat.
Oh, sure. Know? Yeah, absolutely. Do you ever find yourself missing a smaller boat?
You know, I do. And I think there are times I especially miss it because Russel, who does a lot more of the boat work, maintenance and upkeep than I do, has to work so much of the time. You know, there's always a project to be done, or there's always a project to be planning for. I mean, right now we're planning for the haul out we're going to do in spring and buying things and worrying about, you know, this is and that's. And that's that it affects him more than it affects me. I mean, I worry about other things, obviously, you know, so we, you know, have a little division of labor there. And of course, when we're in the boatyard, I work, I mean, do stuff, and there's lots of other stuff. But yeah, having a 26-foot boat where you have an outboard motor and you just get out there and sail and have a great time and you come in and walk away from it.
Simplified.
You know, simplified.
Yeah.
100%.
We went from a 33-foot sailboat, little pilot house, double ender, to this 46-foot trawler, and whenever I fantasize about another boat someday,
it's the little boat. It's because that's the joy of, you know, especially when you the greatest days that a sailor has, in my opinion, it, for us, it's we're out sailing, it's a sunny day, the solar panels are clicking away, you know, you're putting all that power in, you've got, you know, whatever devices that you need, the stereos playing your favorite tunes right off the solar panel, that everything's staying cool in your fridge for your cocktail a little later. Everything's happening for free. And you're sailing along under a solar wind. It's all solar, right? Wind solar too.
Right.
So it's just that wonderful feeling of being at one with nature, self-sufficient, off the grid, but also part of the whole natural world.
Yep.
You're just like a leaf floating along there. The ocean is happy to have you there.
I can totally understand.
I wrote two sentences down at the end of one of your chapters, and it was, I simply existed. I was. And that's what sailing provides for a lot of people.
The zen of sailing. We say that all the time. We're always saying like, oh, let's discuss this or that tomorrow, or solve this problem, or think about this story, or do this. We never do. We never do. Sailing is always less like the hours just go. It's like minutes go by and suddenly hours have gone by, and all you've done is look around or adjust a line, look at a sail, or just.
You've just been. Which is lovely. It's lovely to be.
I don't think a lot of people experience that. You know,
true.
We have boat noises in the background, I think, if they're coming through. We are in the middle of a marina, so I don't know what's being picked up. But
we're rocking and rolling.
I think it's a fishing boat.
But I think people do. I mean, I think you read about flow all the time or being in the zone. You know, some people may do it while walking or jogging mm-hmm. or playing golf or playing tennis or pickleball or playing a video game. I mean, there are a million ways that people can be out of their head and be in the moment. But there's something special about doing it out, you know, in Mother Nature's world.
Absolutely.
I think it provides more opportunity for that kind of introspection and insight. This is going to be one of those edits because I had a train of thought and completely lost it.
Pardon me, boy.
Yep.
Is that the Darren train of thought?
It is. Choo-choo. When we first started looking for a boat, I think just thinking in terms of downsizing and simplicity, which a lot of people are considering downsizing these days as the housing market is, people can't even afford to buy homes around here. So I see a lot of people moving into tiny homes. I see a lot of people moving into sailboats. My wife works with a young couple. They just moved into a sailboat in Port Townsend as well. When we first started looking for a boat, being ignorant and being coming from the mindset of wanting to purchase a home, you're always looking at big yard, big house. So when we first started looking at a boat, I was looking at a 90-foot cement boat, you know, because my wife was like, oh, well, we could have a living room and we can have a room for each of the kids, you know, and total ignorance, obviously. We wouldn't have even been able to get a slip anywhere up here regardless. But now, having owned a boat for so long, it is totally true. The fantasy is like, as small as you can get away with whatever those boxes are that you have to have, you know, in terms of a boat. And so I just am so envious of your lifestyle that you've done it for so long. I wish we had Russel here to hear from him a little bit.
Well, Russel and I are going to be doing a joint presentation at the Yacht Club.
Well, I will experience that for sure.
And
the November meeting, November 11th, I believe.
Now, do you think he found himself as well over these 35 years? What was his experience compared to your experience? And talk a little bit about your relationship, if you don't mind. Because I think
I
that's a lot of people.
Speak for him. He'll love this. No. Well, he was in the process of changing careers. Not really changing careers, but changing within his chosen career. He was an illustrator and very successful. And he wanted to do paintings. So he had a couple of commissions. And he knew that, you know, anybody that saw his stuff knew that he could do this. But he needed to take some time and have a body of work so that he could have a show. And so that was sort of the purpose of this trip for him. And of course, also to enjoy, you know, the lifestyle and the sailing and me sure. enjoy him. When we took off, that was the purpose. I think that he didn't even know how much he was going to love the sailing, even though he knew he was going to love it. Mm-hmm. I don't think he really knew how much it was going to expand our lives and expand our relationship and how much we were going to bond over the lifestyle. And I think that part of that is, you know, for me, was that I grew up at the beach, you know, I mean, I grew up, you know, that was my world, you know, and I think the earliest memories are, you know, tied in with swimming or whether in our backyard pool or at the beach and on the sand or in the canals, you know. So it to me, that was, and for him as well, I mean, he grew up in Oceanside or Carlsbad. So, you know, once they came out from Iowa, so, you know, he was much a beach boy as well. I think we just didn't know how much we were going to like it, but it exceeded our expectations. And I think part of what people are experiencing with the van life and the tiny home and the, you know, simple living, you know, you talk about magazines and everything that are about simple living, is that we're so obsessed in our culture with the things that we have that give us value in our own eyes and in other people's eyes, mm-hmm. that we forget that it's so obvious that it's really just a thing. You know, cars crash and you know, homes burn up and none of it means anything. If you ever talk to somebody the morning after a fire or when our boat went up in flames, I was just so glad I had the photo albums. That was all I got. That was all I saved. And I did not care about one other thing. I could literally sit there and weep for how happy I was that I had those photos. Mm. Now, of course, they're all digitized and in the cloud, so I don't got to worry about it. But for me, that was it. That was all I cared about. Mm. And I think a lot of people feel that way. You know, they get their kids, their pets, their photos, you know, hopefully a couple dollars, you know, whatever, that one or two important things. But we shouldn't have to have something like that happen to us to realize what's really important. I mean, that's a societal shift that's maybe happening. And I think COVID affected people a lot.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they were sitting in their big McMansion going, I feel empty and hollow and sad, mm-hmm. you know, and other people who were just living life and had to work for a living. I mean, whether they wanted to or not, our support system, our workers were all like, hey, dudes, it's life. This is the mm-hmm. way life's always been for me. It's hard and unrelenting work, you know? And so there was a whole different societal shift.
I have a friend that I have to paraphrase. I can't quote her exactly, Danelle. She and her family used to live in an RV and travel. And she had, they had three kids. And they located Port Townsend, built a house. And one day she was talking about how she missed the days when they all had one bowl, mm-hmm. one plate, one mug, and a fork and a spoon. And she missed that. And she had this big, beautiful home that they mm-hmm. built. But that's what she remembers. Mm-hmm. That's a really powerful statement to living small, which is actually living big.
Exactly.
I think the world, you know, marketing and the world around us tells us what we want, but in so many cases, it's not what we want. It's the opposite. My thought is, so this obviously worked for you and Russel and worked really well. You love it. And you're going to continue. And you've been married for 35 years.
Be 35 in May.
Congratulations. I mean, that's an accomplishment, whether you're living on a sailboat or anywhere. Would you say, I'm assuming the answer is no, but is this life for everyone? Can anyone learn to love life at sea or living simpler, small spaces? And what would your advice be to somebody who is considering making a move like this? Because it's a big step. You obviously were very brave, maybe, or just, you know, going along
ignorant?
For the ride. Maybe,
ignorant?
You know, yeah. I mean, I had a lot of ignorance getting into boats. What would your advice be to somebody who's considering this, whether it be somebody who's single or a couple or anything that that is thinking about downsizing and specifically living on a boat?
Well, one thing I wouldn't say is I wouldn't say stay home for the kids, because a lot of people say, oh, I'd like to go cruising, but I can't because we have children. And I'm like, really? Kids don't like beaches and water and being, you know, being in nature and being spending a lot of quality time with you, where you're not torn between 8 million other people tearing at you 24 hours a day to have your time.
That seems like such an obvious statement.
Your device.
Right? Yeah.
You know?
That is what a kid would prefer. But
of course. Yeah. And the kids that we met are amazing people. I mean, the kids we met were like 18 months to like 3 or 4 or 5 years old. Every one of them is successful. Every one of them is in an exciting and interesting career. Most of them have boats or involve boats, but they're merchant marine, they're Navy, they're charter captains. They're just doing their thing. You know, one of them he's the most amazing world traveler. He's done everything from the Gobi Desert, seriously, like in a sailboat made for the desert, on wheels.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just amazing stuff. These kids are amazing. And they're not kids anymore.
Sure.
They're adults. And they're all doing exciting, adventurous things. And their kids will be even more exciting and adventuring. But when I was 9, I totally did not want to go to Europe.
Yeah.
And if my mom had listened to me, my life would not be what it is now. Because living with her and my brothers in that tent and traveling around with our 3 backpacks, you know, with the little bowl or the, you know, I mean, we had one thing. That was our responsibility to do and to take care of ourselves. And it taught us to be self-sufficient. And I used to love to see these little gringo kids, you know, little blonde-haired kids, and they'd run into this village. They spoke no Spanish. The Spanish, you know, speaking kids spoke very little English. And 2 minutes later, they'd be playing.
Yeah.
2 minutes later, there'd be a soccer game or whatever, or they'd be swimming and frolicking and have a great time. There was no problem. I mean, we know this, right? So I wouldn't say it's for everyone, but I also feel like the reasons people list to not do it are not the reasons not to do it.
Sure.
And as I said in the book, if you love someone and love spending time with them, like 24 hours a day time, then there's room for you in the smallest boat. But if you don't have that connection, then there isn't a yacht in the world that's big enough.
And you will learn quickly whether you have that connection. You know, coming out of COVID, I think a lot of people experienced loneliness mm-hmm. like they've never experienced before in their mm-hmm. lifetime. And I think people have perceptions potentially that life on a boat might be lonely. You're on your own little island. You're on your own little boat. I happen to know that the boating community is a community. But can you go into a little bit of that? Like, were you lonely?
Oh, it not one minute that I can think of. Of course, I was homesick occasionally because I had very dear friends who were thousands and thousands of miles away from me. You know, I had a dear friend in New York and I had dear friends in San Diego, and my brothers and I are really close and we still are to this day. So I missed them. I missed my mom, you know. She was like my best friend. And so it was hard to be going through things and not being able to pick up the phone, you know. And sorry, I wasn't expecting that.
It's okay.
Totally I still have that problem.
Sure.
I'd have to make a much longer distance call now, though.
but you can FaceTime today, right? Whereas 30 years ago.
No, I mean now she's in heaven.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah.
A much longer distance call.
Yeah, much longer.
I definitely had homesick moments, but I never was lonely. And I think it was that feeling, you know, of being in the right place at the right time. You know, that I was so grateful. You know, I mean, I may be dumb, but I'm not stupid. I mean, I realized that I was having an incredible experience, you know, and I tried to remind myself of that whenever I forgot it, you know, when I wanted some peanut butter that I couldn't get, or, you know, I mean, some little thing that I, you know, when you get like, I just want a head of romaine. Why is this so hard? You know, things that just in Baja are just a little more difficult.
Yeah.
But, you know, I knew at the time that it was totally, you know, not a real serious problem. loneliness was not a problem. And, you know, I was with my best friend and I still am.
And aren't boaters awesome? Like the community
of
boating people.
The community of boating people. One of the couples that we met, Karen Riley, is still a dear friend. And she's on Facebook and My Women Who Sail Forum. And she's just amazing. And her husband just left us this year. But he was an amazing sailor and just wrote books and just was such an incredible human being. And we've got a lot of those Baja friends that we're still really close to. And we still, you know, shoot each other, you know, missives, you know, now it's more texts and that sort of thing. But, you know, we're all lucky to have that really incredible community. And now that we're in Port Townsend, you know, the yacht club has led to even more groups of friends. And I'm sure there'll be even more of that. You know, and we look forward to having an even larger circle of sailing friends.
Awesome.
That is great. Yeah, I'm just trying to think of, I think we covered pretty much everything. I'm sorry for if we got you too emotional.
Oh, no, I just, you know, you never know. You were talking about something and all of a sudden, oh, where'd that come from?
Yeah.
No, it's good. I mean, it's real, and that's what we're wanting for sure.
Well, let's
let's tell people where to go online again for information.
Yeah, well, so Jennifer, is there any is there anything you would like to, before we close and let people know where to find you, is there any message you would like to get out to people that have read your book, potential readers of your book, or just anybody that's interested in your lifestyle? Is there anything you'd like to get across, a message?
I think, you know, I would love to hear from you. I mean, I'd love to hear from readers of the book and people that have book clubs I would love to chat with. Of course, nowadays you can do it on Zoom, so that's really cool. So if people want to reach out, as you said, my website is jennyredbug.com, and that has my email on it. If people want to contact me, I would love to chat with them and hear what they have to say about the book. And as we said, you know, reviews are important. Thank you. And also my publisher is a small woman known press who's out there, you know, trying to make this happen. And so it's nice to think that you're supporting a small business and a small publisher as well. If that helps, I'll throw that in there too.
Well, we're going to throw a graphic up on the podcast so everybody can see it up close. But again, the book is Honeymoon at Sea, How I Found Myself Living on a Small Boat, a memoir by Jennifer Silva Redmond. I purchased it online as a digital book. I'm also going to purchase a hard copy, and I will get it from our local small bookstore. We recommend that you, our viewers, do the same thing. You're supporting Jennifer and Russel and their life at sea, and they're on the boat, and the woman-owned publishing company. It's all a great cause. And if you have any interest in whether it is boating or downsizing or just being married for 35 years and getting through that, we recommend you check out the book and then check out jennyredbug.com for your blog and for all the other work you do too. Yes.
And I just thought of something else because, you know, your Port Townsend crowd that's listening, I believe the book is for sale at Imprint Bookstore downtown. Okay. And it's also available at Aldridge's upstairs.
Great.
And cool. It's also available at the Port Townsend Library.
There you go. And if it's not available where you want it, please do put in a request to get it ordered. That would support her very much. Jennifer, thank you so much for being on the podcast. We can't thank you enough.
Thank you guys for asking me. What a treat. This has just been such a joyful hour, just flown by.
Absolutely. Great. It would be fun maybe someday to do a follow-up and have Russel on as well, and we can discuss, you know, from his perspective.
he can talk about what
we can get
I
really
thought.
Into the boat. We can get into the boat, the details on and all the stuff. But it was a pleasure having you here today.
Thanks. Thank you. Take a look around here. Surrounded on a ship of fools. Sail away, cross the water, set the pace, and discover every ocean, every sea. Forever and a day for you. Wasted on a ship of fools. Take my hand, just remember you don't have to surrender to the ocean and the sea. There's forever and a day for you.
across the water, set the pace, and discover every ocean and sea, forever and